it's very useful for going up against Pokemon such as Kartana. You know, maybe you don't have much to deal with Kartana, and then it just gets a Beast Boost, and you're like, heh, I'm going to hit you with your own Beast Boost right there.
Foul Play is so good against these Ultra Beasts that are boosting their own attack. You know, like you said, Kartana is probably one of the best ones to catch with the attack Beast Boost. Not so useful against those that get the special attack boost, but it's also very nice against the multitude of Pokemon we've seen running moves such as the Swords Dance, the Belly Drums coming out of Snorlax. With the threat of the Persian, you're really not able to do that. You maximize your attack and then get Foul Played. You're in for a really bad time. If you have Trick Room up as well and Kartana's on the field, the turn you Belly Drum, that Kartana's actually able, the Persian's actually immediately able to deal with it. So very interesting to see how this one goes.
Of course, the Curse variant is a little bit better able to deal with Foul Play, so we'll have to see what variant Caesar decided to run in terms of his Snorlax. Both players right now still trying to figure out what their best options are for this matchup. It is the top eight. It is the single elimination stages right now, ladies and gentlemen back at home watching. So, you know, every decision is going to matter. Every single move is going to matter. You know, you might make one play now, but that might not be the best play that you were supposed to make three turns later.
Yeah, it's everything matters so much more in these single eliminations. There's no way these players want to drop any games, because you do put yourself at an advantage. Game one, particularly when so much is on the line, will give you so much more confidence as you go into game two.
And also gives you a little buffer.
Yes, you do have that option to slip up a little bit, but there is the flip side. If you slip up, your confidence can be shaken for that game three, so you really want to be pushing through with as much as you can. Whoever advances, this will be, of course, their last play of the day. You know, they are going to be going for to top four, which is tomorrow.
And now we are ready to get underway here in the top eight between these two players in Nils Dunlop and Cesar Reyes. Persian and Tapu Koko are the leads that Nils decides to opt for, and Garchomp and Celesteela are the Pokemon that Cesar decides to opt for.
Oh, this lead is very, very positive for Nils, actually. The big threat to his team is going to be the Garchomp that's threatening that Tapu Koko with an Earthquake. He's able to neuter that for a turn, of course, with the Fake Out from Persian. And then this Celesteela is under threat of being caught by a Tapu Koko in electric terrain. Now, he is going to be able to protect it, but that really might not be too useful for him. It might just buy him a little bit of time, really.
Yep, and Persian does go for the Fake Out here, going to target in that Garchomp. Garchomp's Rough Skin is going to activate and chip away at that Persian just a little bit, as Tapu Koko, using this turn to go for a Thunderbolt into that Celesteela slot, as now Garchomp is going to flinch and not be able to move. So now this kind of opens up an opportunity for Caesar to possibly pick up KO on Tapu Koko, as long as he gets Celesteela out safely.
Well, Nils actually has a very strong play on the cards for him here. Knowing that the Celesteela protected, knowing that it's respecting the Tapu Koko, he can double into the Garchomp and try and take that early lead. The way that Caesar has actually led this game means he doesn't have a particularly safe switch in, apart from a potential Mimikyu, to that Tapu Koko. In the same vein, you know, if Garchomp got caught by a Fake Out and then a potential Dazzling Gleam out of this Tapu Koko, not Fake Out, Foul Play, pardon my French, you know, the way it comes through is going to be very, very interesting. I think that's got to be Nils going on the offensive, though. That Celesteela is forced to make a switch or try and protect itself again, and he needs to capitalize on it.
And Caesar almost taking the entire time right there to move. Celesteela switching back out here, going to go into Snorlax. This could be dangerous. Snorlax could be taking an excessive amount of damage here. Persian, using Foul Play, going to go ahead and target down the Garchomp, doing a decent amount of damage, bringing it to a little over 50% right there, as now Tapu Koko is going to get to move, going to go straight for a Dazzling Gleam, going to double into that Garchomp. Should be enough to pick up the KO, and now Snorlax is going to be left out on the field. So great call right there from Nils to double up into that Garchomp to pick up that KO, like you called it, Adam.
You do have to wonder what is going to stop this Tapu Koko now. The Celesteela isn't the answer. You don't want to bring that back in. And it is going to have to be something that really limits the Tapu Koko. Caesar showing his last Pokemon is the Tapu Koko of his own. And there's a very interesting interaction we could have here. Obviously, we've seen Caesar's Tapu Koko on the stream before now, and we know it deals a lot of damage, so the Fairy-type Dazzling Gleam coming out from it could do an absolute number on Persian, but then he's leaving Nils' Tapu Koko available to start dealing a lot of damage back, especially towards this Snorlax. Snorlax doesn't have the opportunity, really, to start setting up right now, and we do know that Snorlax isn't going to have Trick Room from Caesar. Caesar's bringing that Snorlax, entirely relying on Nils bringing it for him. In this case, it doesn't look like he's going to want to bring it, so he just needs to knock out one thing, keep the Tapu Koko around to beat that Celesteela down. I think at the moment, Nils needs to be focusing down on the Tapu Koko.
And Persian now going to switch out, going to go straight into Nihiligo here. Going to try to take better board position. Snorlax now protecting itself, not going to want to get KO'd, not going to want to take a possible Gigavolt Havoc as Tapu Koko on Caesar's side. Going for a Dazzling Gleam right here, preserving that Persian on Nils' side. That Nihiligo had a much better matchup against that Dazzling Gleam. Now Nils activating his Electrium Z, going to go for a Gigavolt Havoc here. Most likely going to target down what I believe is going to be the Snorlax slot, trying to get that KO from that range right there. But since Snorlax protected itself, which is a move that Snorlax don't rarely carry, that's not going to do as much damage as Nils probably hoped.
Cesar revealing, of course, the Protect on Snorlax, showing that he's actually missing one of the most common moves. Protect really isn't popular overall, so that means he's got to be either giving up one of those setup moves that people have been running, or one of the attacking moves. I think throughout the course of this tournament, many people have been just running a normal type attack, but interestingly, he brings Snorlax to just above 50% and the range for the berry. I don't think we can underrate the Nihiligo switch in, because it's so good at taking those hits, not just on the special side of the spectrum, but the typing means that Dazzling Gleam does so little. The Tapu Koko on Nils' side will have to respect Cesar's Tapu Koko, because the Dazzling Gleam comfortably brought it down to under half, so he's going to have to think about that as he plays. And I think the one thing that Cesar really needs to be careful of is losing his Tapu Koko. There's a very safe switch to Celesteela on the cards, but it's not going to be this turn as Snorlax takes the Acid Spray.
There it is, the Acid Spray from that Nihiligo. It is going to reveal that it is Choice Scarf. Going to go ahead and drop Snorlax's Special Defense stage by 2. Snorlax does munch away on its Papa Berry here, going to heal back to full health, and the Dazzling Gleam picks up the KO on that Tapu Koko, but, you know, that's still going to be a hefty disadvantage for that Snorlax, because its Special Defense is dropped, and it won't have the staying power that Snorlax really enjoys. Snorlax does get to go for a Belly Drum, but the berry's already been activated, so Snorlax now is sitting at an unhealthy level of hit points anytime it's below 50%.
Not only is it sitting a very unhealthy level of hit points, as you mentioned, it is, of course, very low on Special Defense. It's not going to be taking a special hit well, and if Nils is able to switch in something that can capitalize on that, he could readily knock out that Snorlax. In the same vein, he may be looking to start setting up some Acid Sprays on this Tapu Koko, using that Choice Scarf that we saw on the Nihiligo with it moving for the Tapu Koko. It's the only way it's quick enough to do that. It's still been doing pretty good damage. It looked bad for Nils when he activated the berry, but with Cesar immediately going for the Belly Drum, leaving his Snorlax at just under half health, really isn't ideal. The Persian isn't going to be able to immediately capitalize on it, but it will be able to buy a little bit of time with a fake out while he reconsiders his options, perhaps.
That is very true. It also depends on how these Pokemon are trained. If this Tapu Koko can outspeed that Persian, of course, that could buy 2 turns of Acid Spray from that Nihiligo, which could possibly even result in a KO because it drops its Special Defenses.
Yeah, he needs to be very careful. Persian probably needs to be going after this Tapu Koko with the Fake Out, so Nihiligo can hit it with the Acid Spray. Then the following turn, Nihiligo, after the Special Defense drop, can catch it with another Acid Spray, while Persian deals with Snorlax. Now, this all relies on one key factor, which is Snorlax not doing anything and Cesar playing scared. If he goes aggressive with that Snorlax after the Belly Drum, then he's going to be in ship shape to do so. If he gets feeling defensive and tries to sneak in one of those recycles, it's going to be interesting.
Persian using Fake Out on that Snorlax, making sure that it cannot move. Tapu Koko does get to move here. It survives the Acid Spray, can go for a Dazzling Gleam. Gonna connect onto Nihiligo and the Persian here. It is enough to pick up the KO on that Persian, so Big knockout there for Cesar, and now it's down to Nils' last 2 Pokemon. It's going to be that Nihiligo and one more Pokemon back. I'm not sure if we've seen it.
No, we haven't seen that last Pokemon yet, but Nils must feel confident that it's going to be able to deal with the Snorlax. He brings his own Snorlax, which is certainly an interesting decision to make here. He probably doesn't have enough in the tank right now with no setup to be able to start picking up knockouts. He needs to pick up a knockout on that Snorlax, and Nihiligo has to divert its attentions over to this Tapu Koko for this turn. So the Snorlax on Nils' side is a little bit behind the pace in the race to set up your Snorlax with maximized attack. It's actually a turn or 2 behind. If he isn't able to knock out the Snorlax on Cezanne's side, he's actually just going to be able to start picking up knockouts all over the show. I think in that previous turn, if he wasn't going after the Tapu Koko with both Fake Out and Acid Spray, he needed to just go for the foul play. He is obviously worried a little bit about the Tapu Koko on Cezanne's side being quicker, though. That's information he's probably gleaned from the Order of the Dazzling Gleams.
The key here is for Cezanne to pick up that KO on Snorlax. Nihiligo's locked in Acid Spray, and of course, Celesteela still is in the back here, trying to position himself in a bit better here. Cezanne now switching in that Celesteela, maybe to take a possible Acid Spray, but Nihiligo does use the Acid Spray into that Celesteela. Snorlax using Facade, gonna hit that Nihiligo. I don't know about that, I guess.
Gets a knockout, that's all you can ask for.
It gets a knockout, but I would have preferred to see a knockout on that Snorlax now. Snorlax using frustration on Nils' side. Snorlax does hang on Cezanne's side, and now it comes down to if Cezanne's Snorlax is consistently faster than Nils' Snorlax.
Nils made the telegraph play. He kept throwing Acid Spray towards that Tapu Koko without respecting the potential, of course, for the Celesteela switch, and maybe forgetting that it was there. But knowing Nihiligo was locked into Acid Spray meant he pretty much always had this game locked up. That Celesteela coming out from the back was very effective. I think if Nils can bring this back, he needs to start getting that Nihiligo out or getting more knockouts with it a little bit earlier. This Celesteela's going to start setting up. Of course, Nils is going to start the fight back.
There it is.
But it may be too little too late.
Cezanne's Snorlax does go for a Facade here, going to connect onto Nils's Snorlax here. Snorlax, such a bulky Pokemon, though, even with that Belly Drum, it does not pick up the one-hit KO. Now Snorlax on Nils' side is able to go for a Frustration onto Cezanne's Snorlax and picks up the KO right there. So now it's going to come down to whether or not Celesteela and Tapu Koko have enough left in the tank to be able to KO this Snorlax.
Nils is really up against it. To deal enough damage to deal with a Celesteela, he does need to weave in a Belly Drum somewhere. Now to weave in the Belly Drum, he also needs to get a Recycle into this rotation of moves to set up his Snorlax. Without that in play, he's just not going to be able to do enough damage to Celesteela. He's also going to have to take attacks from both Tapu Koko and Celesteela. And if he doesn't attack Tapu Koko to try and set up, Tapu Koko's just going to knock him out next turn. So Cezanne looked like he was taking a lot of damage, but he always knew he had it in the pocket to pull out at the last minute.
Ooh, Tapu Koko revealing Electro Ball here, going to slow down Snorlax. But hey, you know what? Just pick up the KO. That's right. I'm thinking about Electro Web. Electro Ball is based on speed.
The speed difference. Yep. It's the reverse of Gyro Ball, which was very popular last year. You want to be faster than your opponent to get an effective Electro Ball off. I don't know if Cezanne actually needed to show that in this instance. Probably a couple of Thunderbolts would have done it. But he's now going to be putting the fear into Nils to bring that Snorlax every time. You don't want to bring it with the threat of Electro Ball. And that's probably an adaptation he's made in this tournament, knowing how prevalent Snorlax is. With the Electro Terrain, the Electro Ball is going to be doing so much damage.
Yeah, and maybe that was just one situation. You don't want to whiff game one in case you don't roll enough damage in that situation. So Cezanne right there just playing it safe, just revealing it. You know what? It's going to be there anyways. I'm going to reveal it, and, well, it's going to be important for me to get game one. Now there's some buffer in game two for Cezanne to get around.
Yeah, I don't think giving that information up is awful. A little bit unnecessary, maybe. But it does make the decision-making a little more awkward if you're on Nils' side of the field. You have to be worried about that Snorlax not being able to withstand attacks from Tapu Koko, as well as you may think. Very interesting that he did Belly Drum in front of a Foul Play Persian. So he is very confident. I think the Tapu Koko on Cezanne's side, the fact it's using Electro Ball, you can probably assume that it's going to be maximized in the way it was trained in speed. That's absolutely essential. Outspeeding that Persian is going to be so, so important. It may not be the case on Nils' Tapu Koko, with it relying, of course, on those Acid Sprays, probably a little bit slower, just more focused on dealing the damage. But Cezanne's very, very fast Tapu Koko needs all the speed training it can get to maximize Electro Ball. Seemed to work out very well for him indeed, putting pressure on so many things on Nils' side of the field. And we did, of course, see that Nihiligo not go for a Sludge Bomb, locking into Acid Spray, but at no point capitalizing on it.
Yeah, absolutely. Now we are getting ready to jump into game two here. Between Nils Dunlop of Sweden versus Cesar Reyes of Mexico. Both players are in the top eight here of the 2017 North American International Championships. Nils, of course, has had lots of success in past tournaments, top eight in the World Championships, top eight here in the International Championships. And now Cesar, who didn't have any accomplishments written at all on his play card, and now he is here one game away from moving on to the top four We're ready now. Nil's going to lead with Snorlax and Tapu Koko. Sazar going to be leading Garchomp and Tapu Koko. You know, in the previous game, we didn't see much from Sazar's Garchomp at all. It got KO'd almost immediately.
Well, Nil's got off to a flying start and KO'ing it with the combination, of course, of a fake out and then a follow-up foul play and Dazzling Gleam. But in this instance, that option isn't available to Nils. And this matchup is actually very, very nasty in Sazar's favor. It's a really tough one for Nils to play against. The Garchomp and a potential Tectonic Rage threatening his Tapu Koko. And as we've been discussing between the games, the Tapu Koko with Electro Ball threatening his Snorlax a lot more. His Tapu Koko is probably forced to keep itself safe from any ground type attacks coming out of this Garchomp. And if Sazar goes on the offense, turns up the heat, of course, on Nils here, then he's going to be able to get some big damage down on this Snorlax. Be curious to see exactly how much he can do, and I think that's probably the play, with Tapu Koko likely going to be leaving the field or just keeping itself safe.
Tapu Koko now on Nils' side, protecting itself. If there is a Tectonic Rage, it won't be doing that much damage at all because it won't be able to fully protect itself. Now, Sazar going for a Volt Switch, hitting that Snorlax, bringing it down to about 60% of its health. Most importantly, not yet activating that berry here. So now Sazar gets some time to switch in a new Pokemon to assess the field situation, which hasn't changed, which maybe he might have expected it to change. And since in Celesteela, Garchomp now using Earthquake here. That's why he switched in that Celesteela. So good call right there. Going to go for an Earthquake, going to hit the Snorlax. Unfortunately, it's going to activate the berry for Sazar. So Snorlax now is going to heal way, way back up.
Yeah, we're going to be in a position, depending on what this Snorlax does, could be very interesting. It eats that Mago Berry, doesn't actually try and get any damage down, just immediately going for a Frustration on that Garchomp. Take a little bit of recoil from the Rough Skin, too.
That is going to be important damage to have down on that Garchomp, because now it could possibly be in Dazzling Gleam range. Although, to be fair, if you look at the hit points, that Garchomp is actually a much bulkier variant than we're normally used to seeing.
Yes, it's one of those very bulky Garchomp, but around this percentage of health, many Tapu Koko, including Nils, who I think is a little bit slower, so likely leaning a little bit more towards its special attack stat, as we've seen it moving after the other Tapu Koko, you know, regularly, may just be very comfortable in getting that knockout. And Nils, every time, just going for this Garchomp in turns 1 and 2. The Celesteela switch in, very nice, because it's able to, of course, freely Earthquake. But I think a little more damage and a doubling down on the Snorlax could have been a slightly better play from Sazar here.
And, oh boy, both players taking all the time in the world to finish picking their moves. Tapu Koko on Nils' side actually switches out, going to switch into Persian here to provide some fake out support for the next upcoming turn. Garchomp continuing to Earthquake here, going to go ahead and hit the Persian and that Snorlax right there, so Nils a bit unconfident as to whether or not that Dazzling Gleam would have KO'd. Celesteela content to set up a Leech Seed here. Going to go ahead and see Snorlax, and of course Snorlax has a very high hit point stat. Snorlax using this turn to set up a Recycle here and trying to stay on the field for much longer.
You do have to wonder here, if Sazar has got inside Nils' head a little bit with the item choice on that Garchomp, because he switched out the Tapu Koko, he must have felt like the Tapu Koko was still at danger from a potential Earthquake, indicating that he may believe that Sazar is running a Choice Scarf Garchomp. He still needs to confirm that theory. You know, he didn't actually have a turn where Tapu Koko moved in the same turn. It switched out manually and protected, which are, of course, higher priority than the order of options. Persian coming back in, taking it very, very well, of course, with that fur coat ability. But he's definitely respecting this Garchomp in a very big way.
Or maybe he just expected to switch from before. I believe they actually saw how fast that Garchomp was relative in the previous game.
Yes, you know, he did see it moving after, but it's still something he seems a little bit concerned about. You know, there was definitely the option to go for the Dazzling Gleam, like you said. He may be concerned it's just too bulky, though.
Persian now using Foul Play, going to connect onto that Garchomp, bringing it down to 30 hit points remaining as Persian continues to damage itself. And now Garchomp going to go for a Tectonic Rage right here, going to be doing a massive amount of damage to either that Persian or that Snorlax. It's going to be close if it can pick up the KO on that Snorlax, so it's going to be so close as Garchomp fully powering up and ready to go.
Any confusion on the item immediately removed. It doesn't go towards that Snorlax, actually going towards the Persian on Nils' side of the field. It is enough to be picking up that knockout, which is rather nice indeed. One of those threats immediately removed. Celesteela covering the option, trying to get another Leech Seed down.
Yep, and Snorlax again using Recycle here. Going to find its Mago Berry, of course. The Leech Seed is going to slowly sap its health back. I believe Sazar thinks that Tapu Koko in the back for him is going to be plentiful in order to help combat the Snorlax, since we saw exactly how much damage that Electro Ball did in the previous game.
Yes, he thinks that's probably going to be the play, especially if he can bring it in the following turn and the Snorlax has taken a little bit more Leech Seed damage and not activated its Berry. The Tapu Koko coming in from Nils, though, has an important choice to make. Does it go for a Dazzling Gleam to knock out Garchomp, or does it go for an Electro-type attack to knock out the Celesteela? He has to make a call on exactly what Garchomp is going to do. If he goes after the Celesteela and Garchomp doesn't protect itself or switch out, then he may lose his Tapu Koko very quickly and be immediately dropped to his last two Pokemon. Nils has the decision to make on this turn, making the prediction. And this is his tournament life coming very close to being on the line.
Ooh, Garchomp here protecting itself. Not going to want to get KO'd just yet. Celesteel also using Protect right here. So really nothing is going to change much. Maybe giving Snorlax a chance to set up a Belly Drum here. Gigavolt Havoc from that Tapu Koko is going to come out. So it's going to target down the Celesteel. Celesteel will not be able to fully protect itself at all.
Smart play there to go for the double Protect. Reading into the options rather well there from Cesar doesn't want to just give something up on a 50-50. He had the option to double protect, and he took it very, very wisely. Of course, Celesteela is still going to take damage from this Tapu Koko, and even through the protect, about 40% of its hit points removed.
Yep, and Snorlax does use his turn here to set up Belly Drum. Now it's going to be set up and content and, well, ready to go. It's going to be ready to do massive amounts of damage. Of course, it does put itself in position to get KO'd by an Electro Ball, even after that Berry is gonna come back, so still not that bad a position for Cesar, although there was an opening for that Garchomp to go for an attack.
Yeah, that Garchomp would have been entirely safe to throw out another Earthquake, and you have to wonder if that was the perfect play, overcautious almost from Cesar. And Nils able to capitalize on it very well indeed. He has the exact same choice ahead of him this time, without the ability to Gigavolt Havoc the Celesteela, but with a little bit of chip damage down and the Electric Terrain in play, you'd like to think that Nils' Tapu Koko almost has the power to do it anyway. Obviously wanted to double down on that slot, see if he could catch something on the switch in with a Gigavolt Havoc, see if he could just 100% secure a knockout with it on the Celesteela. And I just like the way he played that turn. Also, considering the double protect and overcautious play in general, allowed him to get a Belly Drum off, which could be really important here.
Yep, and Tapu Koko picks up the KO on that Garchomp using the Dazzling Gleam. Celesteela now using Heavy Slam, going to connect on to the Tapu Koko here and going to chip away at it slowly, doing a lot of damage actually, but Snorlax using this turn to again recycle, so if Tapu Koko comes back in, there might be a possibility that Cesar could be in good position depending on whether or not it's going to activate the Berry here, and it looks like it might activate the Berry, and it does.
Yeah, very comfortably activating the Berry, putting Snorlax to just shy of full health again. Cesar has to bring that Tapu Koko back in to try and start dealing, I think, with this Snorlax. The biggest concern right now, though, is the Tapu Koko on Nils' side of the field is a little bit low, and I think the Tapu Koko that comes out from Cesar, we saw in Game 1 the amount of damage it was doing to that Tapu Koko on Nils' side. It's had its health already lowered quite significantly by the Heavy Slam from this Celesteela the previous turn. And there is certainly many, many options for Cesar. He has to be making the right call now to set himself up for success in the back end of this game. The Snorlax is going to be forced into continuous recycles, but if it can find an opening to get something big in, of course, like a return onto the Tapu Koko on Cesar's side of the field while the Tapu Koko on Nils' side of the field protects, definitely opening itself up for those positive options here.
Yeah, tough call right here. I don't think the Snorlax will be getting KO'd from an Electro Ball, even though it is boosted by the Electric Terrain.
No, it needs to be a little bit lower, a little bit just above that Berry range to try and get that. And that's why I think Nils has been so keen to keep recycling, because then it's regularly sitting in that full Berry range. And every time Cesar tries to bring it hovering around that range, it doesn't actually get too much value out of it.
And Nihiligo actually comes in to replace the Tapu Koko here. And now Celesteela also switching out right there, kind of worried about what was going to happen. Snorlax does come in, so it's a revolving door of Pokemon as Tapu Koko now using Electro Ball. Going to connect onto the Snorlax here. Going to do a lot of damage. And oh, almost picks up the clean KO from that range. Tapu Koko does get KO'd, but now this Snorlax is actually heavily threatened to be KO'd.
Yes, it's very, very low
actually,
down.
Actually, it's KO'd by the Leech Seed. I forgot about that.
Going to lose to the Leech Seed. No way it sticks around. but I think a little bit safer now that that's gone. Interestingly enough, the Nihiligo is now facing off against Snorlax and Celesteela. That may twist Nils' arm in what he decides to lock in with this Choice Scarf Nihiligo here. Obviously, Acid Spray is not the play against this Celesteela. I think Nils is in a good position purely because his Pokemon are very, very fast indeed. But he has to respect the Snorlax. If Nihiligo locks into something like Acid Spray to try and lower Snorlax's very, very bulky special defense stat so Tapu Koko can capitalize off it, if the Snorlax goes after Tapu Koko immediately while Tapu Koko goes after Celesteela, could end up in a bit of a predicament. So overall, I think the pressure really on Nils to do something useful with this Nihiligo.
It's a mind game right now, because if Nils goes for the Snorlax, then that actually opens up a chance for Celesteela to possibly go for a Heavy Slam onto that Tapu Koko. And from the damage output from that first Heavy Slam, that was enough to pick up the KO. So now, what is Nils going to do, and also what is Caesar going to do? Is Caesar going to protect Celesteela, which seems pretty safe, and use Snorlax to pick up the KO on Tapu Koko, or is it going to be the reverse here? We do know Snorlax does have Protect. Celesteela now protecting itself. Maybe it is going to be Thunderbolting. All right, Nihiligo going straight for a Sludge Bomb here. Going to connect onto that Snorlax, doing a good amount of damage. Tapu Koko now with a Thunderbolt in that Celesteela slot. And it looks like Caesar's going to go for the facade. Going to connect onto that Tapu Koko. And it is enough. No, it's not enough to pick up
Falling
the KO.
Falling Shore is absolutely huge here. There's no Leech Seed down to finish off that last bit of damage. And we see the downfall of using a facade Snorlax. I've talked about this, I've waxed poetically about why I don't like Facade Snorlax, to be honest with you, and that is why, because you fall short of the knockouts. Of course, if it had been poisoned by Sludge Bomb, then it would have got it, and that's a risk that Nils is taking by using Sludge Bomb into that Snorlax. But this turn, Celesteela is going to be at risk from this Tapu Koko, maybe having to buy some time for the electric terrain to run out.
It may be able to survive a Thunderbolt. It's going to be close here. Oh boy, this is still not over just yet for Nils. It's also still not over for Caesar at all. Nihiligo now using Sludge Bomb, going to connect onto Snorlax. Does get the poison. There's the facade boost. And now it is going to go ahead and activate its berry, which, well, if it's poison, the facade damage is going to be doubled that it's going to output. And Tapu Koko now using Thunderbolt here, going to connect onto that Celesteela, doing a lot of damage. Celesteela does get KO'd. And now it's up to Snorlax here. Can Snorlax come back? Snorlax using Facade here. Going to go ahead and pick up the KO on that Tapu Koko. Oh, boy.
You do have to worry about the matchup for this Nihiligo. It looks good, but we've seen there's not really been too much damage from these Sludge Bombs. He actually poisons the Snorlax, giving it a much better Facade. All the problems I have with Facade are now removed, because it's actually got to do all its damage here. It's going to be doing so much. Nihiligo's stuck Sludge Bombing. Caesar knows how much damage that does, and he
builds recycle.
Yep, he knows exactly how much it's going to be doing each turn. Finds its Iapapa Berry, and oh, guess what? It's right back up to full health, so if there's any danger of it being knocked out, he has those opportunities to work in the recycles here. Facade will be targeting down the Nihiligo at some point towards the end of this game. And we know Nihiligo has really low physical defense, especially in comparison to its special defense. So it may be able to just pick up a knockout regardless of the not very effective hit.
Yep, and there it is, locked in the Sludge Bomb. This one not even activating that berry, but that poison will. So really, the Snorlax is going to be healing about the exact same that it's going to be taking. So, you know, you just got to watch out for the critical hits.
Yep, that would be a big deal. But he didn't get rid of the Snorlax early enough, and the more time he spent Sludge Bombing it, of course, the more chance he had to hit it with a big facade. I think locking into Sludge Bomb, very, very dangerous indeed from Nils towards the end of this game. The Snorlax will be able to take this Sludge Bomb comfortably again. It doesn't have the berry yet, but if it goes on the offense, it is going to be an opportunity. Caesar's playing this so, so safely, making sure it always has access to a berry. The poison is going to activate it one more time. Caesar just needs to go for a facade before he gets caught by a critical hit. He may not be comfortable in the damage calculation, but with such low defense on this Nihiligo, boosted by the poison, facade should be enough to do it. I just don't know why Caesar isn't going for it.
Nihiligo now using Sludge Bomb. This one not... Well, you want to be careful. Also, one thing that you actually can do is maybe just stall out the Sludge Bombs, force that Nihiligo. That is also a possibility, but now you're in this position where the Snorlax is pretty low health. A critical hit would be able to pick up the KO, so
It's dangerous.
It's dangerous.
But what he's relying on here is the Sludge Bomb to actually activate the berry rather than the poison damage between turns. We are going to see the Sludge Bomb come in.
On that Snorlax, it is not a critical hit. It is going to go ahead and activate that berry again. He needs to time it right, find the right opportunity to be able to go on the offensive. And Snorlax now finally goes for a Facade here. Going to connect on that Nihiligo. Nihiligo does resist it, so that's not even going to be a three. That's going to be a three-hit KO. So Snorlax needs to hang on here one more time, recycle it this turn.
Yes, he needs to be playing this very, very safe. And the damage coming out is a little bit less than I anticipated, to be honest with you. He's going to have to spend a little more time working in those recycles, bringing his health back up. And like you mentioned, now's actually a really good time to, I believe, just stall out the power points on this Sludge Bomb. It's not got the most power points overall, and Recycle should end up being able to keep him around a little bit more. I'd love to see this Snorlax just keep sticking around and wait for him to run out of power points on Sludge Bomb.
You have to find out what the right opportunity is. You have to find the right window in order to start going on the offensive. There's another Sludge Bomb doing a lot of damage. Snorlax using Recycle yet again. So It's still a long haul here. Caesar doesn't necessarily want to give up. Nils definitely does not want to give up here because this is his tournament life on the line here. Snorlax content on continuing to recycle.
Well, the interesting thing about these moves, both Recycle and, of course, the Sludge Bomb, they do have identical power point amounts. But there is a turn that we've seen where Snorlax didn't do that, so it now has one extra turn of Recycle where it will be forced to take a struggle from this Nihilego. That's something that's really big in this matchup. Of course, this does rely on both players using PP maxes to bring it from the original 10 to 16, but that one turn actually where he weaved in that big, big facade is not the most damaging move of all time, but actually important for the way this game shakes out. The only thing that I believe Caesar has to worry about is getting caught with a critical hit as we see Sludge Bomb after Sludge Bomb connecting with this Snorlax.
Yep, and there is yet another Recycle here, gonna heal back to almost full health again, taking a little bit more poison damage as well. So it's still, you gotta watch out for those critical hits. That's all that Nils really can rely on, or a misplay from Caesar. So as long as Caesar continues to recycle and finding smart and safe opportunities to go for facades, he should be able to steal the deal or even just stall out the power points like we've already mentioned. Again, here's another Sludge Bomb hitting that Snorlax. That looked like a powerful hit, but again, Snorlax here using Recycle, again, just healing back. This one is actually going to almost go back to full health, so it also depends on how many PP ups each player's used. Remember
yes,
that.
That's actually going to be very, very important. And you'd think many, many players at these top levels actually PP max things. So they get all their moves to the maximum amount. In this case, it's going to be 16. We've seen a lot of these moves. I mean, Caesar could end this game. I did think he had the opportunity early on to just try and weave in a couple of facades. He's never let that Snorlax get low, though. He's been playing it so, so cautiously. But every time he recycles, he actually brings his health up a little bit more. The poison activates the berry, and overall, the burying damage in these Sludge Bombs is so important. To see this one stalled out, though, is such a smart play from Caesar. He knows that it's the Choice Scarf on the Nihilego from Nils, and he's just playing to that advantage, just letting that happen. The poison helped out with the facade, also made it a little bit harder for him, of course. Overall, the damage combination from Sludge Bomb and poison is just under what he's recovering with the berry, I think.
The safest thing is actually for that Sludge Bomb to be doing enough damage to always activate that berry at just about 50%. That's what Caesar really hopes for. That way you kind of heal back to almost full hit points, and then that way you can for sure take a possible critical hit if one does come out. So then again, this one here, it looks like it's not going to be activating it. So this one here, he's going to have to rely on not getting a critical hit. So this is Nils' opportunity right here to get a critical hit. This is where Nils needs it in order to be able to pick up the KO.
But he's definitely running towards the end of being able to use Sludge Bomb. He's had to just tap that every single time. You can see we're on turn 22 of the game. Snorlax buying itself some more time to let that berry activate using another Sludge Bomb, drawing us ever closer to the end of the game. Caesar's not even going to try and work in these facades right now.
Yep.
He's not even bothered about it. He knows he's got this game locked up, and that protect is going to be invaluable. I can guess he's just going to recycle every time he doesn't have a berry, and now he's just going to protect every time the berry's not activated. This is a very simple game plan for Cesar. He's now 2 maximum PP away. There it is.
Nihiligo now forced to use Struggle, and that is going to do 25% back to Nihiligo, so yet another one, but most importantly, Snorlax can just go ahead and pick up the KO with the Facade. Cesar Reyes outstalling and moving on to the top 4 here after an intense set against Nils Dunlop. Huge, huge victory for Mexico here. Huge victory for Cesar Reyes. And oh boy, I am excited to see him move on to the top 4.
Slow and steady does in fact win this race. Struggle doing negligible damage. Not enough in the recoil. And Snorlax rounding out this game with a big belly flop of a Facade there. Cesar looking so relieved. He saw the win condition and played to it so wisely. While he could have turned it up with this Facade a little bit more,